Okay, I'm Len Shustek, and it is October 28th, 2016. We're at the Computer History Museum with Forrest Baskett, who has graciously agreed to sit for an oral history. Welcome, Forrest.
Thank you.
In the interest of full disclosure, I should point out that I've known Forrest for 40 plus years, dating back to the 1970s when I was a graduate student at Stanford and Forrest was a professor there, my thesis advisor. Why don't we start at the beginning? Talk about where you were born and your parents and your siblings and early life.
So I was, one of two kids. I had a sister who was 3 years younger than me. It was a lower middle class family. My dad had been a chemical engineer and ended up mostly in sales related jobs in oil industry related businesses, given that that was Houston and the oil industry was the big thing there. My dad was a huge influence on me. He really would stop everything if I had a question and try to answer that question and in a way that would hopefully lead to other questions. So he was just really wanted me to understand and explore the world. So I think that was just a major influence.
Were you interested early in science and engineering? Did you have teachers who helped?
I think so. I was kind of an ADHD kind of kid in school, as you might imagine, and when I was in elementary school, I got D's in conduct because I was, disruptive. The teachers liked me and didn't like me because, I was frequently one of the first people to shout out the answer to any question that came up. So wasn't productive for the other students. And when I was in high school, in fact, I had a math teacher who was really kind of took me under her wing and thought I was in those days people could start in half year increments. So when I started school, I was what was called a midtermer, when I was getting to the point where I might graduate from high school, this was a problem because then what do you do? So she said, well, what you should do is just go to summer school and graduate early and then go on to college. And she was very influential in recommending students to colleges. And so I, ended up going to Rice primarily from her recommendation, it was not a problem, just getting in and going there.
Did your sister wind up going into technology as well?
No, she didn't. I was really, raised by my dad, and my sister was really raised by my mom, and my mom was more of a stay-at-home, homemaker kind of person, and my sister was kind of that way too. So and my sister ended up, getting married and having kids and being relatively, not professional, but more of just a homemaker like her mom had been.
When you went to Rice, what did you major in and why?
Well, when I went to Rice, given my, my interest in things scientific, I started out as a physics major. I actually found that to be boring, and I didn't go to physics classes. I just read the book and went to the exams. So I wanted something more challenging. And so my sophomore year, I decided to be a philosophy major. There were some really interesting philosophy professors at Rice. And in fact, one of them was, I think Alan Robinson was a reasonably well-known logician, and I went through the whole proof of Gödel's theorem as a sophomore. It's fascinating. It's a complicated theorem, but quickly figured out that this was an odd place to be as a profession. And so as a junior, I became a math major, which, you know, I kind of knew how to do. And I liked the, you know, the analytical side of math. And at the time, Rice had a really strong group of faculty and real analysis. And that kind of fit in with the oil industry in the vicinity. But when I was a senior, the math department hired, I don't know, four or five algebraic topologists. And the whole character of the department changed just really dramatically. And the real analysis people were kind of became second-class citizens. One of the famous ones went to the University of Chicago, and or two of them, and started started their careers there, as opposed to, you know, being stuck with these weirdos at Rice. And so, you know, I thought about staying at Rice for graduate school, but, you know, because of that change, I said, well, this is not the right place. And the other thing that had happened at Rice was when I was, you know, as a freshman, I mean, I always worked part-time doing something just to help support myself. And the first year I worked in the library, you know, filing books. But it paid. When I was a sophomore, I decided that, you know, computers were really interesting. Rice at the time had a 1401 and the first Rice computer, which I think had started in 1957, is when that project started.
When were you there?
I was there from 60 to 65. So I went to see a chemistry professor and that I had had a class from and really liked, and asked him if he would hire me to help him with his project on the Rice computer. I didn't know anything at the time. I mean, this was, you know, usual kind of ballsy thing. And, you know, he talked to me and said, well, what he was trying to do was to, he was doing simulations of the lattice gas. So this is a model of gas where molecules can occupy lattice sites. And then, you know, you change the pressure and temperature and see what happens. And so what he wanted to do was to make movies of phase transitions in the lattice gas. And so he hired me to be the graphics guy.
Seems like a perfect fit because it melds physics with mathematics.
It does.
With computer.
Right, it does. So it was really fun. So I had to learn how to program. You know, I had to learn how to run that particular computer.
Were you programming in Fortran, let me guess?
Mostly in assembly language, actually.
Okay.
There wasn't a Fortran compiler on that machine. There was a Genie compiler, and Genie was it was a lovely language. It was dramatically better than Fortran. It was a Algol-influenced kind of, you know, locally developed language. But the Rice computer had code words, so that, you know, had descriptors and could describe, logical segments of memory. And so the Genie language had matrices as primitives, and so you could multiply vectors and add vectors and multiply matrices and add. I mean, it was just really quite.
The machine was a one of a kind done at Rice, and
yes,
the
it
software
was, one of a kind.
Was also unique.
Absolutely right. So the movie making equipment was interesting. It was a cathode ray tube with a 16 millimeter film camera attached to it, and you could put a dot on the screen and put other dots on the screen, put dots on the screen, and then you could advance the film by one click, and that was it.
the screen had persistence? You had to draw?
No, it would just light up.
Okay.
So, you know, blink, blink, blink. But the film was exposing it, so you painted the image that you wanted, and then you advanced to the next image.
But dots only, not vectors?
Dots, yeah, not vectors, right.
It's a challenge.
Yeah. It was fun, and so I really had to learn the machine in great detail, and you know, became really knowledgeable about computer architecture as a consequence, because the architecture of the machine was dramatically more advanced than most computers and at that day and time, and was for a long time, as a matter of fact. Eventually got to where I knew enough that I became part of the systems programming staff there. So moved on from working for the professor making movies to working for the computer staff.
What year was this in your education?
This was 61, I think, is when I started, and then went through 65.
So all during your undergraduate?
All during my career at Rice. And so naturally, this, you know, really interesting new computer at University of Texas really got my attention.
That was the 6600.
That was the CDC 6600. You know, I think Texas had, you know, serial 10 or something like that.
Had you decided that you wanted computers to be your career, or were you still going to be a mathematician?
Well, yeah, I had. Right. And when I thought about graduate school, it was, you know, I thought a little bit about math at Rice because I knew that, you know, do the same old thing. But I really wanted to be involved in computers, and I saw that computer science departments were starting to happen. You know, Stanford had started one, UT started one, a couple of other places had. So they got the 6600.
This is UT really, Austin.
UT Austin. They got the 6600 and they started a computer science department. So I said, I'll do that. And so I went to Austin, went to the computer center, you know, asked for a job, which I needed, and got a job. And I ended up probably within a 2 years running the systems programming staff. So I ended up having about 25 people.
Which ordinarily would be a full-time job, not leaving you enough time to be a graduate student.
Yeah, right. Well, you do what you do. But, you know, my professor, the professor that I eventually decided on to for my thesis work, a couple of us, three of us graduate students, had gotten together and decided that this primitive batch operating system that the 6600 was using could really be replaced with an actual timesharing system with online terminals. And so we went to Jim Brown, who was the early faculty member in computer science, and proposed that we build that system, and that he got the computation center to let us do that and to think about that as their replacement.
So the impetus came not from professors, which is usually the case, but from the students in this case.
Exactly, right. So the three of us said, let's do this, and we went to see Jim and said, this is what we want to do, what do you think? And he said, that could be fun, let's try.
Had you had any prior exposure to timesharing systems?
No, not really.
Okay.
So. But, you know, certainly knew about them, and Project Mac was a big deal. And that's not true, actually, now that I think about it. In 64, I had a summer job at SDC, System Development Corporation in Santa Monica.
Right.
And SDC had a Sage computer. I know you remember the Sage computer.
Oh, yeah.
It was an interesting computer. And it, in fact, had a timesharing system on it. And I, you know, that summer, that's where I worked and that's what I used. And so I did know quite a bit about what made sense and, you know, what you needed to do and how they worked. And
so there's a Sage computer directly beneath us.
Is that right?
That's correct.
That's great. Really quite an interesting machine. I've actually forgotten all the details of what was special about it, but one of the things I did that summer, because it was a kind of an unstructured job, I wrote a Lisp interpreter for that machine, because I'd got McCarthy's book and I read it and says, this is really neat.
And it's very mathematical.
It's very mathematical, and so I wrote a Lisp interpreter for that machine. So that was fun. So I actually, looking at the 6600, you know, that was kind of my model of what made sense, and that's how people should do computing. One of the reasons that I think I was able to do that was when I started work at the computer center, my first job was to write a billing system for the batch system that they were using. And which I wrote it in Fortran, which is what you did in those days. but I, not only did I write the billing system, but I was interested in exactly who the users were and what their characteristics were. So I did a fair amount of data analysis on what the bills were like and who was using what. And as a consequence, I knew who the customers were, and I could talk to the center director about who was important and, you know, what the issues would come up. The customers would always complain, you know, that's what customers do. And I could look at the data and I says, well, here's how to minimize complaints. So I had the data, and that was powerful. That was really powerful.
That's an interesting optimization. Minimize customer complaints, which is not the usual academic target.
Right. So given that I knew so much about the customers and knew how to really make operations run a lot more smoothly than they had, I ended up being in charge of all the systems people there. So that's how that happened. And, you know, in a similar vein, the time-sharing system that we had in mind was aimed at really making the system a lot easier to use and a lot more enjoyable and a lot more, you know, productive for the users, and something that they would complain about a lot less.
Who was the target audience? Were they students there?
There were some students, but there were quite a lot of faculty who were trying to do computing in support of the research, and graduate students who were working for the faculty doing that same kind of programming.
How long did that project last? Was it successful?
Well, I think we probably got the system running in a year and a half, something like that, pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. I mean, the early versions were just somewhat primitive. But it got better and better and better. And that system and, you know, just revisions of that system was actually in production for 10 years, which was astounding, actually.
What were the terminals that people used?
Well, we started off with teletypes. That was the terminals of choice. And they gradually got better, you know, but it was that evolution. It was a TTYs, typing kinds of terminals.
And could people compile and run programs and do all of that? Did you have to write any of those components? Or did you use things that already existed?
We used the the compilers that CDC supplied. So those were, we just made sure that they would run in that system. So we had to have all the interfaces that they were used to, so that kind of defined what the requirements were for the operating system.
How did you deal with the lack of memory protection and other constraints?
The machine had memory protection, but it was on a per job basis. So, you know, you you got a block of memory that was allocated to you, and there was a base and bounds register, and that's what you got. But you couldn't maliciously or accidentally hurt anybody else. I remember Seymour Cray came to visit occasionally, and I remember at one visit, because we were, you know, deep in the bowels of building, you know, and changing and developing the operating system, I asked him, I says, well, you know, can you change these systems so that when you execute a privileged instruction in user mode, that it'll cause an exception instead of being a no-op? And he said,
what was your motivation in asking that?
Well, so that you could basically run operating systems as a user mode and then, you know, take the exceptions and see if things were going right.
Virtual,
you know, the
machine.
Standard virtual machine stuff. And I knew people at IBM and I knew about VMs, and so I said, well, it's obvious right thing to do. And he looked at me and said, no, I don't think so. And that was the end of that. So that was fascinating. It would have been so much easier if we had had that one little change.
Why do you think he was unwilling? Did he not understand?
He didn't understand why that was important and why that would be useful. So didn't want to bother.
Right.
So
did that timesharing system get used anywhere else other than Utah?
No, but it was. It was influential. CDC realized that they needed to do something like that. And Livermore, which was a big user of the same machines, felt like they had to do something like that too. And so several kind of competing efforts sprang up. And I think the Livermore system was the one that ended up becoming more widespread. But I feel like we had really shown the way that you could do this, and it was really, really
there was
useful.
As I mentioned before, a project at NYU, Quran Institute, mm-hmm. to do something similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
That was at about the same time frame, so I don't know who influenced
it. I'm sure we were in communication, you know, because, you know, we all talked to each other, went to the user groups and those things, although the details have faded. So.
So that was your fun project as an employee working on...
Ah, okay. So
what did you do?
So once the system was running, you know, I continued my interest in collecting and analyzing the data from the machine, and I continued my interest in making the system as productive for as many people as possible. And so one of the big issues in those days was job scheduling. You know, how do you choose the next job to run? Because in a timesharing system, you've got a queue of jobs, you know, programs that are ready to execute. Which one do you choose? And how long do you let it run? And somehow I figured out that, you know, I mean, time slicing was something that you know, timesharing systems almost always did, but that's only a very crude characterization of what you do. I mean, you got a queue, how do you sort it? I mean, the fact that you could sort it was an interesting observation. you know, I spent many hours just over the big console watching the system run and trying to figure out what you know, what worked well and when things got slow and why. And I observed that, you know, doing time slicing in a round robin fashion, with the slice being as small as possible, consistent with overhead, was actually the most productive way to run the system. And so that's what we did. I mean, that's how the system ended up running. It ran really well.
Were all these tasks memory resident, or did you have to do swapping to change context?
They were memory resident, right. This huge piece of memory, jobs all laid out in it. And and you can move them around, because the base and bounds register architecture. But I then had gone to a conference where I'd presented some results about how the system had worked, and I met Leonard Kleinrock at the conference, and so I said, well, you know, I'm doing this and this kind of scheduling, and it seems like this is kind of a, you know, the optimal way to run these, this kind of system, and, you know, how do I analyze this stuff? And so he recommended a small book on queuing theory to me. So went home, read the book, says, oh, now I see.
Was that his book on queuing theory?
No, it wasn't. It was a classic book, been, I don't know, probably 10 or 20 years old. And I, you know, then spent, you know, many hours, you know, teaching myself queuing theory and then developing models for how our system worked, and eventually developed a proof that if overhead is zero, that if you take the time slice to zero, so the time slice is epsilon, you get minimal waiting times for all the jobs. And then consulting with some other colleagues, one at UCLA in particular, we figured out that there were a couple of other versions of that theorem, and ended up with a pretty widely cited paper in the journal of the ACM. With the first, it was my thesis, and then it became this really quite well known, highly cited paper.
Who was your thesis advisor?
Jim Brown was my thesis advisor, so he was.
Was he very helpful and involved?
He was helpful, but I wouldn't say involved. I mean, queuing theory was not his thing. You know, he felt like I was, you know, doing the right thing, and he prodded me and poked me, and, you know, looked at drafts and all that sort of stuff. But I was kind of really out there on my own, except for my colleague at UCLA that I worked with on it. So
you mean Kleinrock?
No, it wasn't Kleinrock. It was one of Kleinrock's colleagues there, Mutz. Dick Mutz was the, and he was a younger person than Kleinrock. He was slightly older than me, but a young faculty member there.
So cool. When did you get your doctorate at UT, and what were you thinking
about
doing next?
That was in 70, end of 70, you know. And then in 71, as I kind of finished up, I took a temporary job there as an assistant professor from 70 until 71. And, but I, you know, finished in December, and I think it got, you know, stamped by the university in January. And then the question is what to do next.
Exactly. Do you want an academic career? Do
right.
you want a career
yeah.
in industry?
So I was, you know, I was already teaching at that point, and in addition to running the computer center, which was, you know, challenging but fun. And so that spring, you know, I interviewed for academic jobs. You know, I can't remember how many places I interviewed, but it was quite a number of places. There were lots of jobs. Computer science departments were springing up everywhere, and so it was easy to get interviews.
Did you also consider industry jobs at the same time?
I didn't. I didn't know what industry could do for me at that point, or why that would be interesting.
So you wouldn't want to work for CDC, for example?
No, I knew I didn't want to do that. Had enough dealings with them to know that was not a good idea. So it turned out that one of my graduate students, office mates, had had summer jobs out in the Bay Area, and had become friends with a professor at Stanford that his wife had worked for, and my graduate student friend called this guy at Stanford and said that, you know, I was interviewing for jobs, and if they had jobs, they should talk to me because, you know, I was worth talking to. And it was actually two of us. As I said, there were three of us that started the timesharing project, and and we all kind of finished at the same time. And so the three of us ended up often on the same interview trips together when we were thinking about what to do next.
Who were the other two?
Herb Schwetman was one, and John Howard was the other. John and I ended up interviewing for a position in the computer science department at Stanford.
Who was the professor that you had been referred to?
Oh my God.
Do you remember who you interviewed with when you went to Stanford?
Well, I went through the whole rigmarole. You know, I gave a talk to the department, and most of the faculty and most of the graduate students were there.
Do you remember how big the faculty was at the time?
It's probably 10 or 12 or 13 people, 13 faculty members. And it was an interview for a joint appointment because Stanford had joint appointments between electrical engineering and computer science. And there was a group called the Computer Systems Lab. Originally it was the Digital Systems Lab, but then it became the Computer Systems Lab. And so Ed McCluskey ran that lab. I don't know if you remember Ed. You know, they had interviewed a lot of people, and I think their first choice for the job turned it down and went to Xerox PARC. And John and I both got offers, and because John was from Massachusetts and had been an undergraduate at MIT, and I was from Texas and, you know, was kind of a native Texas boy, all of our friends said, well, John will go to Stanford and Forrest will stay at UT. And of course, exactly the opposite happened. John stayed at UT and taught there for quite a while, and I went to Stanford. Became part of the computer systems lab. My office mate, since there were two jobs, the other person that got hired was, instead of John, was Vint Cerf. And Vint and I were office mates in those early days.
So describe the atmosphere and the machines and the research projects that were going on.
this is a part that you'll remember well. When I first arrived, there was still a Burroughs, you know, B6500 that was being used, and I don't think I ever used that. And there were mini computers which had kind of showed up, and we had some of those in the lab, and of course there was a big IBM machine out of Slack, and so one more thing I forgot, there was the the DEC PDP-10 at the AI lab, which was out at Felt Lake. So I ended up getting an office at the AI lab and at Slack so that I could use those two machines.
So at Slack, the PDP. At Slack, it was the 3691.
It was the 91,
and
right.
It was the PDP-10 under McCarthy and
under McCarthy and Les Ernest and that whole crew. Those were great days.
What did you do? What were you working on?
I continued to do, you know, performance analysis and, you know, thinking about what made systems work and why, and, you know, what kind of models you could construct that would indicate how they worked.
And teaching.
One of the things that I had observed at UT was, and I've been struggling to remember the name of the company. It began with a D, but it was one of the first CRT-based replacements for typewriters. And it was a small screen.
Wasn't Data Point.
Data Point, yes, okay. Thank you. It was Data Point. And I looked at that and I says, wow, you know, this is where things are going. At Stanford, one of the things that happened at Slack was that you and I connected, and the Intel 8008 came out, and random access memory chips came out. So all these things happened, and Xerox PARC was building the Alto, and we decided that we could build something like that. And I certainly had experience with CRT screens back when I was an undergraduate. Knew how to put dots on a screen. So that just seemed like a fun thing to do. And so we built a really interesting machine that had some, it had some architectural characteristics. I don't know if you remember how we structured the memory banks so that the display would automatically do the DRAM memory refresh so that it didn't have to have a separate refresh cycle.
During the retrace intervals.
We
called it the video graphics terminal, and it had two modes. One mode that was text only, where it could store lots of text, and the other mode was
a graphics.
Graphics mode of 640 by 480.
It was 640 by 480, right. It was a P39 phosphor because that had nice long retention times, and so you didn't have to worry about refresh rates very much. So yeah, those were fun days, and it was kind of computer architecture on a small scale. What happened later after that was, and I can't remember exactly how much later, but a new graduate student in EE came to see me, saying that he was interested in hardware projects, and he was looking for a hardware project. And he told me some of the things that he had done when he was an undergraduate at CMU. And I said, well, you know, I have this thing in mind, which was kind of the 8086 had come out as a processor, and it was dramatically more interesting than the old 8008 line and the 88 line. And of course, memory had dramatically improved and all these other things. So I had become involved with Xerox PARC, and I knew how the Alto worked. So I said, well, you know, I have a project in mind. And so we sat and talked about it.
That graduate and, student was?
Sure, it was Andy Bechtolsheim, right. And so Andy and I basically, you know, conceived of and designed most of the original Sun workstation as a project.
Based on the 8086 or the 68000?
Well, what happened was we started off thinking that it would be the 8086, but after we kind of started talking about it, the 68000 came out. And you know, I looked at the 68000. I said, "Oh, wait a minute!
That's a real computer."
Reset. Yeah, this is a much better computer. So we switched to the 68000, and I think we ended up with the 6810 as the original processor. And I designed a memory mapping system for that processor, which it kind of barely had the capabilities to do memory mapping, but the original Sun workstation had a really fascinating memory mapping system. I was a little annoyed with Andy because years later, I discovered that he had patented that memory mapping system and had not bothered to tell me about it or put me on the patent, because And, you know, I had a paper that described it, so that was, it didn't matter.
That sounds like prior art.
Yeah, it was, right. But, you know, who knows? It's no big deal.
What was the attitude in the computer science department and the electrical engineering department to engineering-like projects like this? So the computer science department had been derived from mathematicians and
yes.
George Forsyth and so forth.
So, you know, I had a lot of graduate students. You were one of the best. Andy was amazing, although Andy left to form Sun before actually doing a thesis. And had asked me to come with him as well, but that was not the right time for me. But the computer science department had a history of hiring assistant professors in kind of a systems kind of area, and then when it came time to promote them, they didn't make it. So one of the things that I did was I went to, I took a leave of absence in my fifth year, or sixth year, I can't remember, and went to Los Alamos, which had just acquired the serial one of the Cray 1, to work on an operating system for that machine. and so we did that. It was a really fun project, not as successful as I would have liked, but it was a really interesting project and came out with some pretty highly regarded papers about the structure and such.
That system was called DEMOS.
It was called DEMOS.
What was unusual about it? What was special?
The structure of the operating system was inspired by capabilities, but it wasn't hardware capabilities, it was software. And so it was a structure where, you know, things had tags and the tags had meaning, and you could, you know, you could build a you know, general purpose utilities that reacted to the tags. And so it was a very clean, elegant way of constructing an operating system, file system, et cetera.
So. Was the hardware sufficient? Had Seymour Cray learned any lessons from the 6600 days?
well, as I said, you know, it was a lot better. Yeah, it was a lot better. But it was still a base and bounds kind of machine. But
was it virtualizable?
Yes, it was. I think it was. That he had gotten to that point, and we used that as a matter of fact in debugging the new versions of the system as we developed them. But anyway, you know, when then I was, you know, up for tenure, and I was still coming back to Stanford and talking to my graduate students on a regular basis, and so I went to see Don Knuth, and I said, Don, you know, my tenure case is coming up, and if you want me to stay at Stanford, you're probably going to have to get involved in this tenure case. And I don't know if that was effective or not, but he did get involved, and I ended up being the first systems faculty member at Stanford to get tenure. Mm-hmm. So, and. Then it got better.
What was the department and the university's attitude in those days toward the connection between what their faculty did and commercial projects like Sun? Like, we tried to commercialize a video graphics terminal. We
right.
went up to Tektronix
yes,
and tried to
right.
sell it to them. But that's almost a commercial activity.
That's a commercial activity. And I think the department really didn't think about that much at all, other than it was a convenient way for our faculties to consult and to have summer jobs and things like that, but not really in the way that that we see it today at all.
Were they interested or aggressive about getting patents on work their faculty had done?
No, not at all. It was not, never came up. I mean, you could do that, but it was just...
You were on your own.
You were on your own. I mean, there was a technology licensing office, but you know, you had to kind of reach out to do that. The other interesting thing that happened was that Vint and I, when the appointments were 3-year appointments, and so typically if you were going to go through the whole process, you get 2 3-year appointments and then you'd come up for tenure. So at the end of our first 3-year term, Vint and I were both joint appointments, computer science and EE, and we said, well, you know, this is kind of a double jeopardy situation, which it was. And Vint and I said, well, you know, why don't we trade halves and, you know, each of us be full-time in one department so that we wouldn't have that. So we did. We went to the various department heads, and Vint said, I want to be, you know, full-time EE, and I went to computer science, and I want to be full-time CS. And they looked at us and said, okay.
Why not?
Yeah, so it was why not, because it didn't change anything, because the departments cooperated really well.
So now you have tenure, and that's usually the introduction to a lifetime of academic service?
It is, and you know, there was a lot going on in terms of startups at the time, one of the things that that happened to me, which was, it was a kind of a personal situation, was that I had a daughter just before I went to Los Alamos, and you know, she got a little bit bigger in Los Alamos, and then we came back, and she was still very young, and my wife at the time developed you know, bipolar syndrome, and I ended up really being effectively a single parent because she was so unable to participate in raising our daughter. And so one of the things that I tell people about being an academic is that it's a really hard job. And you know, my description is that it's really 3 full-time jobs. You know, you have to be a full-time teacher. You know, teaching is very time-consuming. You have to be a full-time researcher. That's what Stanford expects. And you have to be a full-time administrator, because there's a lot of administrative burden that goes with that job. So I took another leave after a couple of years of being a tenured professor, and went to Xerox PARC. And you know, that's a fun place to be, a lot of smart people, interesting projects, and extremely low stress, you know, low demand. You know, your schedule is your own. You know, you go to meetings, but there aren't that many of them, and they're fun. You work at your own pace, and it was really wonderful to be able to have that kind of intellectual stimulation, but also to be able to get my daughter to a point where she was older and more able to make it.
And there were so many amazing things going on.
And there were so many amazing things going on.
What did you get involved in? What did you work on?
Well, so I met Bob Metcalf at Xerox PARC, and I met John Warnock and Chuck Geschke at Xerox PARC. And Andy was taking the Sun project out to do that. I had hired, another thing that happened before I did that was a guy had showed up at my office at Stanford, and he said, well, Bob Sproul had recommended that he come see me. And I said, oh, Bob, sure. I knew Bob from the Xerox PARC connection. And so he sat down and said, but you know, he was an assistant professor at UC Santa Cruz, And he had this idea that he wanted to pursue, and he didn't think he could do it at Santa Cruz. And so he wanted to come to Stanford to work on it.
And this person was?
This was Jim Clark. All right. So, and the project he wanted to work on was the geometry engine, because one of the things that we had gotten involved in was the Meade-Conway VLSI revolution that happened about then. And I think that revolution was really important in that it enabled graduate students to build integrated circuits. And previous to that time, that was something that only specially trained wizards could do. And that kind of democratization of that technology, I think, really changed the world in some really important ways. And I'm not sure people realize how important that was. But I think it just caused, you know, integrated circuit development to explode as a consequence. And the whole ECAD world came into being as a consequence. One of the things that I did when I was on leave at Xerox PARC was to write ECAD programs for the integrated circuits that I was also working on. And it was an amazing time, really was. And just to indicate how amazing it was, because at Stanford, Jim had come into this research project that I was running. It was a big DARPA project, and had started developing the geometry engine as part of that project, which was very successful. And he got to the point where he had a working system, a piece of silicon that did all of the 3D transformations that you needed for 3D graphics.
Was he using the Meade-Conway system?
Yes, absolutely. Right, yeah. And, you know, DARPA had a program where you could use Meade-Conway and you could use Moses to get the chips made. And so you can build systems, you know, silicon systems at a university. It was really quite remarkable. So he got the original geometry engine and the original, you know, 3D graphics workstation running at Stanford with about six graduate students. And so I'd taken a leave at Xerox PARC and gone over there, and Jim was over there quite a bit as well for various reasons. And Jim said, well, he was going to, you know, start a company to commercialize this technology, which turned out to be silicon graphics. And he wanted me to join, and I said, well, you know, I'm busy, you know, being somewhat of a single parent, so I appreciate the idea, but I just can't do that.
Did you think you would stay at Xerox PARC indefinitely, or were you going to go back to Stanford?
No, I guess I thought I might go back to Stanford, but, you know, what happened was things were really changing in my mind about what was exciting, because, you know, Jim asked me to join his startup, Silicon Graphics. Andy wanted me to join him to do the Sun Workstation and Sun Microsystems. Chuck Geschke and John Warnock called me into their office and said, well, we're leaving Xerox PARC and we're going to start a company, and we'd like you to join that company.
Adobe.
That was Adobe. Bob Metcalf called me over to his house, sat in the kitchen table with, you know, I don't know if you remember Ron Crane.
And he's a volunteer at the museum.
Yeah, right. Said that he was starting, you know, 3Com, and he wanted me to join that. And there's probably something I forgot, but it was it was a crazy time. And I mean, it was unbelievably exciting, you know, productive.
So weren't any of these appealing to you?
They were all appealing to me, except that, you know, I was really still seriously engaged in raising my daughter without a lot of help. So, you know, I just didn't feel like I could leave that kind of safe environment for what I knew was, you know, a 24/7 kind of job, which startups are. But eventually, you know, my personal life got, you know, more predictable and schedulable. And I, you know, one of the graduate students that I had had at Stanford was a guy named Sam Fuller. And Sam, he was actually Ed McCluskey's graduate student officially, but we worked together and did a whole bunch of papers together. And he then went off to CMU to be a professor there. And he was there for 5 years and had gotten to know Gordon Bell. And at the end of 5 years, he decided to join Gordon at DEC. So that was earlier. So when I was at Xerox PARC, I was thinking, well, what do I do next? My life is getting a little bit more under control. And, you know, I looked at, you know, I still was in touch with Sam quite a bit. And I said, Sam, you know, DEC needs a research facility on the West Coast. You guys are just missing out on everything that's going on out here, which was tons. And Sam said, yeah, that's a good idea. And I said, well, why don't we do that? So I started what we call the Western Research Lab for Digital Equipment Corporation. And so at that point, I quit being an on-leave Stanford faculty member and visiting scientist at Xerox PARC and became a full-time employee at Digital Equipment Corporation.
What did your colleagues at Xerox PARC think? Are you starting competition for them?
No, they didn't think that. They didn't think about competition really. And they all wrung their hands about Xerox's ability to commercialize anything. You know, they had a great job, but they didn't really think about. You know, they'd gotten their fingers burned with the Xerox Star project, and so it was not a big deal.
Now, Xerox PARC had a sister organization that was supposed to commercialize
yes.
some of the technology.
Right.
DEC did as well. Didn't they have the Systems Research Center? What was the relationship?
Okay, so that's an interesting situation. The commercialization unit for Xerox was a real live commercialization unit. So when I was leaving to go to start the Western Research Lab, Bob Taylor, who ran the research lab for Xerox at Xerox PARC, once he gave up trying to convince me to stay at Xerox, he said, "Well, you know, Forrest, can you hold a place open for me?" This is a true story. Because, you know, things had gotten a little awkward at the corporate level in Xerox, and Bob was concerned about what their future might be. So I went off and started the Western Research Lab, and then about 2 years later, you know, Bob wanted to talk to me, said, you know, things are just really falling apart. You know, is there anything we can do? And so I talked to Sam, and together we decided that, yeah, we should start another research lab for DEC in Palo Alto, and that was the Systems Research Lab.
So what was the difference between the two?
The Western Research Lab, you know, we built hardware and interesting machines that were kind of very relevant to what DEC was doing as a business, and the Systems Research Lab was more abstract, and they did a lot of interesting systems projects, but none of them were directly relevant to the mainline business of the company. They were more, you know, what might happen. It was really more researchy, whereas the Western Research Lab was more applied, I'd say. Which is kind of what had happened to me is I developed various systems. I wanted to see them actually happen. Gotten bitten by that bug.
What was the track record? Did you wind up doing
things
that?
Well, yes. Our big project. Backing up a bit. Back at Stanford, you know, when we started this big DARPA research program. one of the people that was a new professor at Stanford was John Hennessy. And he and I ended up being kind of office mates a bit. And when we started this project, I asked John to be, you know, part of the research team for this big DARPA project. And when we got the award, you know, John came to see me and said, well, what are we going to do?
What did DARPA think you were going to do?
Well, it was about VLSI. You know, it was about kind of taking that whole Meade-Conway thing and moving it forward in a way that was going to, you know, be helpful to the world and to DARPA in particular. I said to John, I says, well, why don't we build a machine? And John said, great, that's exactly what I wanted to do. So that was the MIPS project. As you know, and
yet another company you could have joined.
And that's the one I forgot, right? Because that happened too. I was invited to join MIPS.
There were other activities going on, as long as we backtrack to Stanford,
yeah,
that didn't involve doing VLSI, but were still breakthrough architecture. I'm thinking of the S1 project of,
yes,
Kurt Widows and Tom McWilliams,
right,
where they did a lot of design tools to.
They did a lot of design
tools.
ECL
machine.
Yes, and that wasn't custom silicon. It was off the shelf silicon, but it was computer architecture and it was building hardware. Yeah, and they built an S1. It's really quite an elaborate machine. You know, John and Tom and Kurt were graduate students of mine. You know, and they did very well. When they finished their graduate work, they started, what was the name of their CAD company?
Was it Cadence?
Or no.
Synopsis?
After Cadence.
We'll think of it.
Yeah, we'll think of it. And so they built a bunch of CAD tools and built a CAD company that was quite successful. It was kind of what Cadence should have morphed into, but no, it was Daisy. It was after Daisy. And so they used Sun workstations as their vehicle, and they put software on that for ECAD, and it was hugely successful. So that was just...
But that was a different world from the VLSI design CAD systems.
Yes, it was. It was ECAD. It included VLSI as well. But it was moved up a level so that you could do complete systems with it. How did we get sidetracked on this?
We were going back to the Stanford and the work with MIPS and
MIPS, right? And so we built. When MIPS really got going, I had kind of drifted off into the Xerox PARC thing, and so I was really kind of an advisor to the team, although I did some of the early instruction set design work on it. And when that got going, you know, John wanted to know if I wanted to join that as well. So didn't do that either. So, but it was a great, great success. Anyway, when I started the Western Research Lab, the question was, well, what to do? And says, well, the RISC thing had happened, you know, and the RISC project at Berkeley, the MIPS project at Stanford, obviously, you know, quite successful academic projects. RISC had become something that Sun then started pursuing, you know, commercially. And I said, well, you know, DAC needs to really understand this because the VAX is not a RISC machine, and eventually that'll hurt.
Why not adopt one of the other architectures?
Well, they were pretty primitive at the time. And my thought was, in order to really influence a big, you know, momentum-heavy company that had the VAX and VMS kind of being, you know, very successful revenue engines, that I would have to do something that made it clear that there was a better way to do things. And So what we, the DEC was working on a on an ECL version of the VAX, which they had never done before. And my thought was, well, we'll do an ECL risk machine and it'll be faster and cheaper and they'll notice.
Most of the other risk machines were not ECL.
That's right.
They were MOST.
They were not. So we built what was called the Titan. I don't know if the Computer History Museum has any of those or not.
I believe we do.
I think you must.
You built dozens of them. Right?
Oh yeah, many dozens actually. And it turned out that it had about 60,000 gates, and it ran at the same cycle time as the 8600, which is
single chip processor.
No, both of those machines were discrete. The 8600, the DEC commercial VAX,
right.
Used ECL gate arrays,
right.
And the Titan used just standard packages.
Okay. So you weren't designing your own ICs?
No ICs. But you know, we had to make it work. You know, I ended up writing timing closure software to get to figure out how to make it all work. And the machine ended up being about twice as fast with about a half to a third of the components.
But software incompatible with the VAX.
But it was software incompatible with the VAX, which in it was incompatible in some easy ways, and then there were some stupid things that we did that we shouldn't have done that held us back. But nevertheless, how are we doing in time?
We're fine.
Okay. It did get the attention of the DEC establishment, and in fact, three independent competing projects sprung up in the various engineering organizations inside DEC.
To build machines based on this design?
No, to build risk machines that were more compatible, but still they were risk machines. So there was one which was an ECL machine, and there was another one which was a kind of a more traditional TTL machine, and then there was one that came out of the the people who were building integrated circuits for other parts of DEC. So they decided they wanted to build a complete microprocessor, they eventually all killed each other off. But they were more clearly in line with what DEC was normally doing, and so Titan was simply something that caused that to happen, but didn't have a legacy of its own other than that.
But did DEC decide on none of these risk machines?
Well, the design that came out of the VLSI group after they killed each other off got reborn and became the DEC Alpha, and it was slightly different from what they've done in the first version. It was very good machine. And
what other projects were there at Western Research Lab in addition to Titan?
Well, what happened at that point was that we got to the end of that project, and the question was what to do next. And I was a little frustrated by what had happened with respect to these competing projects that then all killed each other off. It just seemed like such a waste, and so the corporate bureaucracy was beginning to bother me.
Similar to what had happened at Xerox PARC.
Yeah, right. Similar to what had happened at Xerox PARC. And so a startup contacted me about trying to hire me to be part of their startup. And it was a high-end graphics workstation thing. And the guy who was running it was I listened because I didn't quite know what to do next, and I was discouraged with DEC, and so I talked to his founders and what they were doing. It didn't seem like it was going to be the right thing in terms of being a commercial success to me. But the guy who was the lead guy, the CEO there, was at a party, and he thought that he was going to hire me, and he was basically bragging about it at this party, and one of the people at the party was Jim Clark, and Jim said to himself, "He can't do that." So Jim calls me the next day and says, "Look, you know, I know you turned me down the first time, but we're going great guns. You really should reconsider and come to SGI."
Can you say who the competition was?
Well, I'm trying to remember. It was that, it was the company out here that merged with the one in Massachusetts. High-end.
Not Apollo.
No, the one, the Massachusetts one was the one that came out of Apollo. And what out here? Geez. I can't remember the names.
Okay.
So Jim calls me the next day, comes over to the house, talks to me. And
so if I got the dates right, this is about 1986. You had spent 4 years at the Western Research
Lab. Right. And Silicon Graphics was 4 years old, as a matter of fact, as well. So,
okay.
Because all those startups happened around 1982. Just amazing year.
So what were you hired to do? Was it an easy decision to go to Silicon Graphics?
Well, what happened was they were having a hiring open house the following weekend, which is something that companies sometimes do. And you know, they were shipping machines and they had customers, and so I went to the open house and talked to a lot of people and looked at what the machines were like. And
these were 68,000 based.
These were 68,000
graphics based workstations.
Graphics workstations. That's right. And and I said, well, you know, this is really, really cool stuff. This company can be successful, and they're doing interesting, you know, interesting work. They wanted me to kind of be a head of R&D kind of person, almost a CTO, although Jim was really the CTO. So I thought, well, this is cool. These people all are on the same wavelength. You know, they're not playing politics. They're building systems. They're satisfying their customers. You know, they got a clear vision. You know, Sun was still black and white at the time, for example. Mm-hmm. And this was not only color, but it was also 3D. And Sun was mostly black and white and 2D.
What stage in their corporate life were they? They had venture capital investment, but had
they had venture capital investments? Yes, Mayfield and NEA were their lead investors, and they were getting to the point where being a public company was kind of on the horizon. So I joined, and probably 6 months later, we started organizing for an IPO, and we did that IPO and became a public company. That was a great experience. What?
Good timing for you.
Good timing for me. Yes, Jim was made that clear, of course. and then you know I had a very long career at Silicon Graphics, 13 years. So, and it was an interesting situation. It wasn't perfect from a corporate perspective because, Jim is kind of a volatile person, really super creative and insightful and thoughtful, but but also kind of emotional. So the board, early on, almost from the beginning, had teamed him with a CEO. You know, he was the chairman, and there was a CEO. And the first CEO was kind of not terribly great at running such a dynamic business. The second CEO was Ed McCracken, who was hired away from HP. And Ed was a really good CEO, actually, really good. Knew how to build and run an organization. But Ed and Jim just didn't really get along that well. I mean, they worked together and, you know, they collaborated and they talked about the directions and what the next product might be and all those things, but they really didn't get along that well. And Jim would always complain about Ed, and Ed, in his own quiet way, would complain about Jim. And I got along with both of them. And so I was kind of an intermediary between these two explosive personalities. And I did that for years and years and years.
No, you were in mainline product development. You are now not doing research.
That's not exactly true. I didn't have line responsibilities, but I was involved in all of the projects that were going on as kind of a, you know, let's make sure we do this right, and, you know, who do we need to hire, and, you know, what are the technologies we need to incorporate and not incorporate. And I remember after I'd been there about 6 months or a year, the guy who was the official VP of engineering came to see me one day and said, well, I've got this guy, you know, I just don't know what to do with him. He's really a talented guy, but I can't manage him, you know. Any chance that you know, we could have him work for you? So I became the zookeeper. And so I ended up having about 25 direct reports.
Who was that person that he tried to give
you? That was Paul Haberle. I don't know if you ever ran into Paul, but unbelievably creative guy, you know, technically talented, but extremely artistic as well. And he could make our machines do things that were just amazing. And it was just really wonderful and delightful and extremely productive to have him around. But you just had to let him do what he wanted to do. You couldn't ask him to do anything, and you couldn't tell him to do anything. So
I've known many engineers like that.
Exactly.
Did you take people from Stanford, from PARC, from DEC?
Yeah, all those things. Okay. Absolutely. Right. No. You know, Silicon Graphics became one of the exciting places to work in Silicon Valley. And we ended up getting up to about, I don't know, 13 or 14 or 15,000 employees at the peak, and it was really quite a phenomenon. It was a fun place to work.
So let's talk about the products and projects that you were involved in. When you came there, they were building graphics workstations.
Graphics
workstations
based on the 68,000. So, and we did a couple of iterations. When I came, the second generation product was kind of underway and getting ready to come out. And
that was Iris, or what came after Iris?
Yeah, that was the first one was Iris 1400. The second one was the Iris 2000. Okay. And so I became heavily involved in the Iris 3000, which was kind of the third generation product. That was a big success. Because we'd kind of smoothed off all the rough edges and made things work really well and had a, you know, an excellent version of Unix running on it and a really good file system, and it's very high throughput and, you know, had all the compilers that you might need.
Now, these were expensive machines, right?
And they were expensive machines, right. And it was interesting how we designed the machines. And this was the design philosophy for the first four or five generations. The starting point was 1500 watts, because that's how much you can pull out of a high-end wall plug. And so the question in terms of designing a machine was, well, what can we build inside that power envelope? And, you know, VLSI was happening, and chips were getting more and more powerful and more power efficient at the same time. So you could build, you know, bigger and faster and more powerful machines inside that power envelope, you know, in successive generations. So that was kind of where you started, and then you kind of partitioned up the power into how much memory and how much, you know, I/O and, you know, what kind of CPU and
these were all based on Motorola 68.
They were, but MIPS was underway at the time, and so one of the things that I did was to, you know, lead the charge on switching from Motorola to MIPS, because the MIPS processors were about twice as fast, you know, and same price.
Had you been making multiprocessors out of the Motorola parts?
No. The Motorola systems were uniprocessors. And the first MIPS processors, the Iris 3000s, were also uniprocessors. So the thing that followed the 3000 was the first multiprocessor. And so I was heavily involved in the architecture of that and making that work.
Did you worry, now that Silicon Graphics was a big company, about depending on single source vendors like MIPS?
Well, yes, quite a lot. And in fact, you know, MIPS became threatened as a company because there was competition. The DEC Alpha was one. You know, eventually we said, well, you know, this is really critical for us. And so we arranged to buy MIPS, and MIPS became part of SGI.
That was an expensive acquisition, 1992 for $300-some-odd million.
Is that right? I've forgotten the details. Yeah. Right. Cool. But it worked. It worked. And we, one of the things that we did after we had that team was we started a very high-end MIPS project, an ECL MIPS machine, but custom silicon. And that was the R8000, and very effective, powerful machine, tremendous floating point capability.
Was that a successful project?
It was a successful project, yes, it was. It was short-lived, didn't last long because...
It was a captive market. It was only used in SGI machines.
It was only used in SGI machines.
What was the calculus about buying MIPS, which sold chips to other people who might have been competitors with SGI?
Yeah. Well, you know, our mission, and we were pretty true to it, was until we started building big multiprocessors, was graphics systems, 3D graphics systems. And we were fairly confident that no one else could build 3D graphics systems like us. So selling MIPS chips for other purposes didn't seem like it was a problem.
So that other business continued on after MIPS was acquired.
It did. But I think it wasn't as vital as it had been, because kind of tailed off.
So what happened after the MIPS acquisition? What was happening to the business? What was happening to the marketplace?
I mean, we just you know, began to build all of our systems using MIPS chips, and they were excuse me. We had a great VLSI team, and they built great processors, and we could get them fabricated at, you know, TSMC or wherever. So it was just part of our supply chain, so to speak.
Were you building custom graphics chips as well?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. We've been doing that for a long time. Right.
You must have been watching what was happening to PCs and their graphics chips.
Oh, yes, right, right.
Which market did you try to be in? Were you interested in higher-end and lower-end markets, or
well,
the middle
yes.
market that you were
We very much, you know, had a pretty much of a stranglehold on the high-end graphics market. And so the aerospace companies and the auto companies and all those people were all, they just bought our machines. We developed what we considered low-end machines, you know, not PCs, but dramatically smaller and less expensive, excuse me, less expensive machines, and so we had a low end. And then we even ended up with a team doing mid-range machines, which is a questionable strategy, but we did it for a while. And one of the things that happened during that process was PCs became very powerful, and that was noticeable to all of us. And one of the engineers said that he wanted to build graphics for PCs. And his notion was that we could take the graphics that we had built for our low-end machine and simply adapt that graphics to a PC and make a graphics card. So we let him do that, you know, and he built a graphics card that was a the original version of it was with in a special deal with IBM using the microbus, because they had their PC that used the microbus and nobody else used that. And he said, well, okay, you know, we can easily adapt this to an ESA bus and then sell it to the, you know, Dell or whoever. And we did that.
This is called the Visual Workstation, is that right?
Yeah, right. Okay. And the microbus version went into the RS3, what was the IBM RISC machine called? RS something. You know, out of Austin.
Right.
So it went into that. And that was a successful product line. You know, again, they were newcomers. They didn't have all the software. They didn't have all the applications. They didn't have the ISVs, and so we didn't feel threatened. And it was a nice contract, and it kind of got us into a different kind of business. So when we ended up with the ESABUS machine card, one of the things that happened that I just seared into my mind, the CEO said, "Well, you know, this is basically a low-margin business."
CEO McCracken.
McCracken. So this is a low-margin business, and we're a high-margin company, so we're going to stop doing that. Mm-hmm. And
did you disagree with that?
I did. But, I mean, it was a business decision, and I kind of wasn't the business person. And what then happened was that a lot of engineers who could see where the world was going started leaving the company. And there were about 35, at one count, startups in Silicon Valley to do low-end 3D graphics.
NVIDIA being one of them.
NVIDIA being one, yes. But there were 35 of them.
Wow.
And they were mostly populated by at least one, sometimes four or five SGI people. And it was really tragic. But, you know,
the company must have seen that happening. What was the reaction?
There wasn't a strong reaction, partly because we didn't quite know what to do. One of the things that we did do is we spent time talking to Intel, and we did develop an Intel-based version of our low-end graphics workstations. But, you know, the whole software environment was so different, it was hard for that to succeed because it had to compete head-to-head with the rest of the PC business.
But you had been selling or licensing software into the PC industry anyway. I think you sold the Irix or licensed the Irix graphics library to Microsoft for NT. I mean, the software you developed was getting out into that.
Yes. We did believe that the graphics library needed to be a standard, that would be part of growing the whole ecosystem around 3D graphics. So one of the things we did was, and I was very heavily involved in that myself, spent a lot of time in Redmond figuring out how to license the graphics library to Microsoft. And we pulled that off, and that was, and so OpenGL was what the result was called. And OpenGL is still supported by Microsoft to this day. And it was a big success. So I think that was absolutely the right thing to do. And it just, you know, you had to build a bigger software environment, and you couldn't have a closed system.
But you were doing that in part by acquisitions, Alias Research, Wavefront Technologies, Paragraph.
Yeah, those were more at the higher end of that graphics. The OpenGL was the basic 3D graphics library. And Alias and Wavefront were well beyond that in terms of the tools and the systems that they provided. So they really served our high-end market, which was where most of our profits were. I mean, that's where the real margins were and the kind of captured customers, so to speak.
In the meantime, some of these competitors at the low end were using technology that was quite similar, and I think, didn't you sue NVIDIA over some patent infringement?
Oh, probably.
You weren't involved in that?
I wasn't involved in that, right.
Okay. So you were making these kind of moderate to high-end graphics workstations and seeing competition come from below and the low-end PC end. But you were also getting into the high-end supercomputer
business.
We
were.
Now, how did that happen?
Well,
why?
Because that was kind of a natural evolution. We had so many customers who were doing, serious simulations and associated 3D graphics renderings of those simulations that we could build, and because of things like MIPS, we could build processors that were just really state-of-the-art in terms of their computational abilities. So a lot of our software vendors would do the simulations on the workstation and have interactive displays of those simulations. And so it was how we think about computing today, that it's interactive. It's not a batch thing where you do a simulation and then you do rendering. We then said, we started selling systems primarily for computation because they were so good at computation.
So like the Power Challenge.
Yes.
The RISC multiprocessor could be $500,000.
Right, exactly. So we said, there's a big market for this kind of computational capability, and we started building successively bigger and more connected and integrated multiprocessor systems. It became really a big business for us. And we started, competing in the supercomputer world. So, and that led to, had some kind of disastrous consequences where when we acquired Cray Computer.
So who are you competing with in the supercomputer world, and why was Cray thought to be a good strategy for dealing with that?
We had tremendous market penetration in the government labs and in the agencies because of this high computation, high graphics integrated system. It was easy for us to understand what their computational needs were and how much I/O they needed and what kind of I/O subsystems made sense. And to design and build those things and then have a fairly ready market for them.
So was Cray one of those competitors that you were dealing with by buying, or were they
a supplier? Cray was not really a competitor because it was kind of a major step above us. But we ended up, in some cases, building, 1,000 processor systems for labs that were an alternative to Cray's, and so in that sense there was some competition. The Cray's were big honking machines, and we had these clusters of very powerful and highly integrated multiprocessors. And, you know, my argument was that the microprocessor engine was on the CMOS power curve, and that the other technologies just couldn't compete. And if you just did the arithmetic, the Cray kinds of technological approaches just didn't make sense.
So who was the advocate for the Cray acquisition?
Well, you know, to a certain extent I was, not in terms of pushing it. What happened was Cray really got to a point where they needed help, you know, financially, because they spent so much money doing development, and their sales were limited, the thought was that we could integrate a complete product line, and this would make sense. In theory, that was an okay idea. In practice, the Cray culture was so different that it was kind of met the end of SGI as we knew it.
Do you think it was the Cray acquisition which was the...
I do, yeah.
It was, financially, it was a disaster. I mean, it was a $740 million acquisition in 1996, and 4 years later, it was sold for $35 million.
Yeah.
And in some sense, it wasn't the business that SGI was in.
That's right. Right. Well, that's not true. Our computation business was at least half of our business by then. Okay. So you have to really look into the business to see that that's not an accurate statement.
Right.
We were in that business.
What you're saying is that what killed SGI was a bad move into the high-end supercomputer business, as opposed to the conventional wisdom is that it was killed by the low-end graphics PC progress.
Right. Well, both of those things happened, and the PC started eating away the low-end kind of early on. And, you know, we pretended to participate because we had an Intel version of our workstations, but it was so brutal down there. The alternative path for the company would have been to really dive into the low margin, high volume, you know, PC graphics business.
To become NVIDIA.
And become NVIDIA, exactly. And that's what we should have done. You know, it's easy to see that in hindsight.
Right.
But that's, you know, we took the high road. And that's what, you know, Ed wanted to do, and it's you know, part of why he got fired. You know, it got to the point where, you know, anyone could look at it and say this was a mistake, and so the board said.
So in retrospect, what could people at SGI have done differently?
Well, we could have not done the Cray acquisition, maintained our coherent approach to high-end multiprocessing and maintain that business. There is a business problem, though, in blending a high-margin, high-end business with a low-margin volume business. That's hard for companies to do. So I'm not sure, you know, that one company could have done that.
Maybe the right answer would have been to split the company.
Might have been. And that's not something that we thought about in those days, but today we would think, yes, that's the obvious thing to do. Rather than kill the graphics card business, spin it out and form a technically integrated but business-wise separate entity. That would have been absolutely the right thing to do.
So sales were plummeting. This was 96, 97, something like that. And McCracken leaves.
Mm-hmm.
And another HP veteran comes in, Beluso.
Yes.
You stayed through that era as well. What happened then?
I stayed for 2 years with Beluso in place. Because I was trying. I said, well, you know, it didn't make sense to me in the beginning, but, you know, I had a lot of friends there and people that worked for me and people that I was just, they're really tight, close colleagues. And
sure.
wanted to kind of keep the ship running, so to speak. But, you know, got to the point where this is ridiculous. This is not going to work.
Any thoughts of taking some of those good people, colleagues, and starting a company on your own?
No, I didn't. I didn't have an idea that was burning in my head that I wanted to pursue. I knew a lot, and I, you know, had been exposed to all this technology. And one of the things that I did at SGI because of my position was I was kind of involved in almost every technology discussion that we had. And there was lots of new technology that was bubbling up, so to speak. And, you know, little companies would come to us and say, you know, we can do this. You know, you ought to adopt this as part of your system. And I was in, you know, 99% of those meetings. And so I saw all that stuff all the time across a
And SGI had done a number of acquisitions.
And SGI had done a number of acquisitions. These were mostly not acquisition targets. These were, you know, buy our product, our subsystem or our component kinds of discussions. And one of the things that happened was that, you know, after these meetings, you know, one of my colleagues would say to me, he says, "Wow, you're really good at that. You should be a VC." Happened over and over. So when I got to the point where it just, you know, it was clear that the SGI wasn't going to work, and you know, I couldn't do anything about it. I did resign, and you know, decided that, you know, I'd go out and look for, see if I could be a VC for real.
Okay. We'll get into that in a second, but just at the final end of your time at SGI, there were interesting decisions being made, right? They were dumping MIPS and signing on to the Itanium bandwagon.
Yep.
Was that?
Well, you know, Intel pushed us to do that. We had built, you know, x86 based workstations, and you know, Intel, you know, encouraged us to think about doing that, and there were a small group of people at SGI thought they could do it, and so that was a short-lived project, I think.
Had Itanium been successful, would that have helped save?
Might have
SGI.
It might have, but I never believed that it would be successful. Never. Hmm. It was just too bizarre. You know what I mean? Yeah.
So you decided to become a venture capitalist, mm-hmm. which is a very different kind of activity because you wind up giving people advice and watching them make mistakes and maybe be frustrated that you're not in there helping them fix it?
Yes and no. You know, my joke even today is that being a venture capitalist is a lot like being a professor. And the difference is that when you give people advice, they tend to follow it.
Because you hold the purse strings.
Exactly. So that's not completely true, but it usually gets a laugh. But it is a case where you get to see lots and lots and lots of new ideas from very creative, mostly young people, and you get to work with them, some of them, about developing those ideas. And it's really terrific.
Obviously, you enjoy it. You've been there 17 years.
That's right.